This video was made possible through the support of my patrons. Due to Doctor Who's format, you've got the ability to essentially tell three different types of stories. You've got your present-day contemporary, your futuristic sci-fi, and your historicals. Obviously, you can take those formats in very different, more abstract and creative directions, but that's a simplification, and it made sense for Doctor Who's 2005 revival to open with what amounts to a trilogy featuring this format. As the Doctor says, Rose has seen the future, and now it's time to take a look into the past. Welcome back to the Trip of a Lifetime, and if you want to keep up to date with me on this journey, as well as other Doctor Who related discussions, be sure to subscribe, ring the bell icon, and let's get 19th century up in here with the Unquiet Dead. So our setting is 1869 Cardiff, where Charles Dickens, played by Simon Callow, is away from his family in the final months of his life, performing at live shows. However, one of his shows gets interrupted by a spectral visitor, possessing the corpse of an old woman. The Ninth Doctor and Rose happen upon the event and discover the source is coming from a funeral parlour, where the dead have been walking there for some time, and there's also a woman with a psychic gift. It's up to our heroes to find out just who these gaseous creatures are and what they're after, and just what can be done about the walking dead. Now, it's hard to talk about a story like this without mentioning its writer, Mark Gatiss, a huge fan of the classic era of the show, and he was a prominent writer in the Wilderness years and in the early years of Big Finish. Being part of the League of Gentlemen creative team, he's well known for his macabre sense of humour, and I think that, outside of the showrunners, Gatiss is the closest thing to an auteur writer that we've had in the revived series.
Oh my god, it's really him! I've not cried this much since Henrik died!
With his best traits on full display in The Unquiet Dead. Firstly, we have the morbid subject matter. These aren't alien bodies, these aren't possessed people. They are corpses. That lack of pretense of a conceit gives this episode a real edge to it. We have references too, and in-jokes, with my favourite being the Gelf possessing a door knocker, Jacob Marley style, much to Charles Dickens's horror, and we also have Gatiss's trademark sense of humour.
That's how I got the house so cheap. Stories going back generations. Echoes in the dark. Queer songs in the air and this feeling like a shadow passing over your soul. Mind you, truth be told, it's been good for business. Just what people expect from a gloomy old trade like mine.
But let me back up, because I really want to talk about the opening. I promise I won't do a scene-by-scene breakdown, but this is one of my favourite pre-title sequences. From the opening shots showcasing the gas lighting, establishing a key plot point right off the bat, we also have the lovely character work portraying Mr. Sneed as a caring professional, but he's also fully aware of the issues he's having with the corpses right now. We've got the gruesome concept of a grandmother coming back to life and killing her own grandson, and we have the long shot of the zombie walking towards the camera enveloped in the blue gas, with the beautiful location work and the snow in the Victorian city providing an immediate contrast to last week's futuristic, clean interiors circling a sun. The Unquiet Dead wanted to demonstrate that Doctor Who can do range, and this opening scene allows it to prove that and hit the ground running. Superb. Also, remember that this episode was also directed by A. Ross Lynn, who did The End of the World. Basically, what I'm inferring is, find a director who can do both, and you may think I'm just fanboying here, and maybe I am, but seriously, look at this framing. Look at it. Look how dynamic that is. Look at that depth. Mwah. Though I get the sense A. Roslin resented the production team for setting the long conversation scene between Rose and Gwyneth in such a cramped cupboard. God, I can feel the camera operator just squeezing behind Eve Miles to try and get that over-the-shoulder shot. Okay, I'm done now. Okay, moving on. And then the Doctor and Rose arrive and take a moment to contemplate their lifestyle. Also, I am watching these episodes back to back, and they weren't really designed to be done like that. This is pre-Netflix and pre-binging. But this line from Rose.
Not a bad life?
Better with two.
Feels like such a great direct continuation of how the last episode ended.
I'm left travelling on my own because there's no one else.
It's me.
And then Rose steps outside, to Christmas, though she thinks it's Naples when she's actually in Cardiff, but the point still stands. I love the crunching snow sound effect when she puts her shoe down. Then her and the Doctor link arms and leave their literal footprints in the history books. Sure, the production budget limits 1869 Cardiff to just one very big street, but they manage to hide it well, with brilliant period costumes, street lamps, the snow. It's wonderful. This is such a gorgeous looking episode. The seance is beautifully filmed. I love the Gelf gathering behind Gwyneth, the Doctor glancing over to Rose from across the table when the Time War gets mentioned. This shot of the Doctor stood alone in the doorway, brilliant shot after brilliant shot in this episode. Doctor Who was always able to make great looking historicals, mainly because the BBC storage rooms would have great period costumes and props that they could use, but it's great to see this tradition make its way into the revival. But it's not just the look and the feel of history that makes its way to this era, but we also get strong character work as well. There's a really refreshing character turn for Charles Dickens. The episode could have just given a flat arc interpretation of a famous author, thrown in some references to his books, and called it a day. But here, we get a more realistic and grounded portrayal of a man nearing the end of his life, believing himself doomed to repeat the same stories over and over and over again because he thinks he's learned all there is to learn. But then, along comes the Doctor, and he gets swept up in this adventure and learns that he's barely scratched the surface, and that realization fills him with a renewed life. He almost goes through the same arc as Ebenezer Scrooge, and I love it.
God bless us!
It was the script's objective to prevent giving Charles Dickens a stock and dry characterization that drew Simon Callow to this role in the first place, especially since he's well known for his biographies about the man, and having played him in several other TV shows and stage productions. I wish that the episode was a tad longer so the audience could see a bit more of the world-weary Dickens before he meets the Doctor, but this is really great stuff here. Callow is brilliant, and you do hang on to his every word, which is key when you're trying to sell that this guy is one of the world's most famous storytellers.
Now, it is a fact that there was nothing particular at all about the knocker on the door of this house. But let any man explain to me, if he can, how it happened that Scrooge, having his key in the lock of the door, saw in the knocker, without its undergoing any intermediate process of change, not a knocker, but Marley's face. Marley's face!
I even like how he contrasts with the Doctor, though not in an antagonistic way at first. The Doctor wants to fanboy about his books and his work, but Charles wants to set forth on adventure and rescue Rose.
But who exactly is in that hearse?
My friend. She's only 19. It's my fault. She's in my care. Now she's in danger.
Why are we wasting my time talking about dry old books? This is much more important. Driver, be swift! The chase is on!
Yes, sir!
And later on, the Doctor yells at Charles and tells him to shut up when he refuses to believe what's happening with the gas and the bodies, only for the Doctor to apologise and explain his thinking.
Can it be that I have the world entirely wrong?
Not wrong. There's just more to learn.
While the Doctor's influence has already helped Rose to step out of her comfort zone and helped to motivate Jabe in the end of the world, this feels like the first explicit example of the Doctor living up to his namesake and making people better, turning this embittered man into someone who decides to get the next coach home to his family for Christmas. The Doctor in this story is depicted as an observer, frequently smiling and enjoying the human interactions in front of him, relishing humans and their idiosyncrasies. There's a sense with this story that Mark Gatiss gets the Doctor as a character. Eccleston's Doctor is often looming in the background, in scenes throughout the second and third act, but it's not always as the voice of reason. You see, it's not all smiles and fun and adventures, as the Unquiet Dead brings up an interesting moral question. Is it right to donate bodies if it's to help save another race? It's revealed that the creatures are called the Gelf, and there's very few of them left. They're able to live inside the natural gas systems that lights and heats the funeral parlour, as well as inhabit corpses, due to them naturally breaking down after death because of their enzymes. Obviously, the episode doesn't go quite in depth in terms of the logistics, but it still works to add legitimacy to this alien threat. Although, this could be me just being absolutely stupid, but how did our heroes kick the Gelf out of the corpses at the end? How does flooding the morgue with gas draw them out? Someone smarter than me, could you please let me know in the comment section? Rose thinks the bodies need to be respected, and that Gwyneth shouldn't get involved and help the Gelf use the corpses, whereas the Doctor just sees it like recycling, and it doesn't matter if it's not polite or decent. This almost reads as an extension of the Doctor's philosophy from the end of the world, where it's not so much the planet that matters, but the humanity and the life that comes from it. The Earth and human bodies are just the vessel for that humanity, but the episode is fair and balanced. I don't think the episode looks down on Rose's argument or perspective, but it does seem to showcase that this 19-year-old woman, who's only in her second journey in the TARDIS, is a bit out of her depth when it comes to having these conversations. That's not to say she's wrong, but the Doctor's been around the block for a few centuries and is able to make his case more effectively.
You can't let him run around inside the dead people.
Why not? It's like recycling.
Seriously, though, you can't.
Seriously, though, I can.
That's just wrong. Those bodies were living people. We should respect them, even in death.
Do you carry a donor card?
It's different, Les.
It is different, yeah. It's a different morality. Get used to it or go home.
Ultimately, Gwyneth is the tiebreaker and volunteers herself to the Gelf. The Doctor also might be morally compromised here and easily manipulated by the Gelf. Yeah, I'm sure he'd normally try to help as best he could, but once the Time War gets name-checked, he's like putty in their hands and willing to do anything to make amends.
Thing is, Doctor, the Gelf don't succeed. Because I know they don't. I know for a fact that corpses weren't walking around in 1869.
Time's in flux, changing every second. Your cozy little world can be rewritten like that. Nothing is safe, remember that, nothing.
The Doctor, very much leading the charge here, rushes into this decision to help them. He doesn't ask the Gelf any follow-up questions, he doesn't even wait for the Gelf to agree to his terms before he lets Gwyneth give herself over to them. Have you ever noticed that? He lets the Gelf know what the plan is, and they don't reply.
I'll take you somewhere else after the transfer. Somewhere you can build proper bodies. This isn't a permanent solution, all right?
My angels. I can help them live.
Okay, where's the weak point?
Then Gwyneth goes under the arch, everything goes wrong, and she sacrifices her life to close the rift. A heroic death to save the world, but one that didn't need to happen if the Doctor didn't let his guilt get the better of him.
Sorry. Thank you.
But let's talk about Gwyneth, this innocent though charming servant girl who lost her parents when she was 12 and taken in by Mr. Sneed. Eve Miles is great here, taking what could have just been a flat and virtuous character and making her feel like someone with real life experience, as sheltered as it might have been. The scene between Gwyneth and Rose is lovely as well, and further follows the through line of Rose being able to relate and talk to the staff as opposed to the toffs on top. Also, further developing the characters and the Series 1 arcs, Gwyneth accidentally drops the knowledge that she knows that Rose's father died years ago, and is able to see the big bad wolf with her sight. And this line, which stood out on my rewatch.
My father died years back.
You've been thinking about him lately more than ever?
I suppose so.
Fast forward 5 episodes later.
When we met, I said, travel with me in space. You said no. Then I said, time machine.
But we'll talk about that when we get there. But yeah, this is a lovely conversation as the two gossip and, you know, talk about boys.
There is one lad. Butcher's boy. He comes by every Tuesday. Such a lovely smile on him.
Like a nice smile. Good smile. Nice bum.
Well, I have never heard the like.
And all this humanizing of Gwyneth makes her sacrifice at the end, striking the match in a gas-filled room to hold the Gelth in the rift, so bittersweet. Honestly though, I don't have too much more to say about The Unquiet Dead. It's just a really strong historical story with very little wrong with it. You know, I've got my nitpicks, like I mentioned wanting more of Dickens earlier on in the story, the confusing nature of the climax, and some of the world building doesn't quite add up. The Doctor says that Gwyneth got her powers by growing up above the rift, but she's only been in this house since she was 12, and that she's had her powers before her parents died, because she said her mum told her to hide it.
I can't help it, ever since I was a little girl. My mum said I had the sight, she told me to hide it.
Also, much like Rose, the episode, the sound mixing is all over the place. I had my TV remote on hand the whole time, watching my Blu-ray, because when the Gelth screamed, it was 10 times louder than everything else.
My name's the Doctor, who are you then? What do you want?
Failing, open the rift, we're dying. And this form cannot sustain. Help us.
But folks, if my big complaints about an episode are an iffy backstory and sound mixing, you know that I'm reaching deep into the coffin for this one. The Unquiet Dead is the first home run of the revived series so far. Mark Gatiss' script manages to walk the delicate balance of being simultaneously filled with awe and wonder, but also horror and morbidity, being genuinely creepy, but never skimping on the character legwork. And of course, the whole thing just looks and sounds beautiful. Shout out to Murray Gold's music, it's sublime. However, not only does the trip of a lifetime not end with The Unquiet Dead, but it actually branches off here, as the rift in Cardiff and the heritage of Gwyneth would have far-reaching implications in the universe of Doctor Who, but we'll get to that later on down the road. For now though, after Rose's experience throughout time and space, it's time for her to do something that no other companion in Doctor Who, on screen at least, has ever had to contend with. Coming home. The trip of a lifetime goes domestic next week in a political thriller which will bring not just London, but the entire planet to the brink of war. I'll see you folks next time. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching this third installment in The Trip of a Lifetime, The Unquiet Dead. I hope you enjoyed the review. If you did, hit that like button, subscribe, keep up to date with all of the content that's going to be coming from this series in the very near future. You can also leave any comments in the comment section below. It appeases the YouTube algorithm, helps to keep my kids fed, and by kids, I mean my cats. I have 2 cats. You don't want to see them go hungry though, do you? Those are the easiest ways to support my channel. However, you can go one step further and become a patron. You can get access to these videos weeks, sometimes months in advance. You can get access to a private Mr. TARDIS Discord server and way more other perks. All of that info is in the description below. And I'd like to give a particular shout out to these patrons. Their names are scrolling on the screen right now, but I want to give a shout out to these very special individuals. Anne Neubauer, Matthew Perry, James Raby, Dean Jones, Andrew Blewett, Callum Baird, Daniel Davis, Dylan Whittaker, Flabu, Joseph Adams, Katie Maxwell, Palex, Raven Woods, Rebecca Hill, Shazeb Mangi, The Brit Sniper, Zachary Taylor, aka Mario Fanboy 15, Dan Morrison, Darius, Nathaniel Holden, Samuel Brooks, Zarby 555, and Luke Jenkins. Thank you so much for watching this review, and I'll see you next time for Aliens of London and World War III.